Alright, so we're here to celebrate the launch of Shaman, which is set in an ice age. Which one are we in?
The last
one. The last one. The last one. Which might come as a little bit of a surprise to regular readers of Stan's books. It's, you know, extending science fiction, if you like, back in the other direction. But Stanley Robertson, the Nebula and Hugo award-winning author of the famous Mars trilogy, Red Mars, Green Mars, and Blue Mars, of the Science and DC trilogy, of Antarctica, of The Use of Rice and Salt, many other acclaimed and truly wonderful science fiction books that I highly, highly recommend to you. Is here to read a little bit of Shaman. I have a couple of questions to get us thinking about it. And then if anybody's got any questions in the audience, we can go there as well. Anyone ever read Stan's books before? Yeah, we have a few people, good to know. We have some new readers, which is also good. So Stan, I'd just like to invite you first to read us a little bit of Shaman.
Thank you, Ken, I will. And because I don't want to read at great length, I have a passage that is, I would guess it's 5 or 6 minutes, and it demands to be read standing. And you just have to imagine, a night by the campfire, like all the other nights by the campfire of the last 100,000 years. But this one about 30,000 years ago. And I think it helps, given that it's a kind of a geography story, to know that this is the people who painted the Chauvet Cave. So it's about 32,000 years ago, and it's basically in the summer, in southern France, and near the Ardèche. So, night by the fire, and a traveler has come by, and is here to tell the story. I am a traveler, as you know. I walk the surface of Mother Earth, and so do my fellow travelers, each of us on his own path. And some of us repeat our paths as long as we can find them, and nothing makes us take a different way. I am one of those myself, having a wife with my brother, and he goes out when I'm at home. And he doesn't like it when I'm overly late, although both of us have been delayed once or twice through the years. What this means for me is I go out east to the gate between worlds, and then turn north and walk for a fortnight, right up to the edge of the great ice cap, and come back just under that great white wall, or sometimes on the ice itself, if the summer melt has made the land next to the ice impassable. West I return, and south across the steppes to home, using paths of my own that no one knows, the best ways of all. That's the way it is for me, that in my travels I meet other men I walk in the world, and some of them have neither circuit nor home, but wander always a new way. These men are curious people, odd in their ways and speech, but interesting for that, and we talk. Always when travelers get together over a fire, we talk. You can see that right now, I know. And travelers together talk about traveling. Where have you been? What have you seen? What are people like? What's out there in this world we live on? These are the questions we ask and the stories we tell. And some travelers travel to find the answers and tell new stories to those they meet. One such I met this summer, the farthest east of all the places I go. This man looked like the Northerners, and I could barely understand him, but I could. And it got easier as we talked, because he had only one thing to talk about, which was this world we live on, its shape and size. All travelers agree, for we've seen it ourselves. There's ice to the north, wherever you go, and to the west is the great salt sea, and to the south, again the salt sea, although warmer and more calm, more in and out, and dotted with islands. We all agree on this, we travelers, as between us we've seen it all. And some travelers claim to have seen it all themselves alone. Good. Maybe they are even telling the truth. I can't say. But here's the thing. What about east? This northern man was like a lot of us. He had that question. And more than that, he wanted to know the answer. And no one had it. So he took off walking east, he said. He walked for days. He walked for months. He walked for years. He walked east from the time this question had come to him in his youth and kept on walking until he was a man in the middle of life. 17 years, he said, he walked east. I asked him what he had seen on this life walk. He told me of steps that went on forever. there were mountains like those to the west of here, and some lakes bigger than any I've seen. Little salt seas even. The water was salt, he said. But mostly, it was steps. You know what that's like. The walking is good if it isn't too wet, and there are always animals to eat. So really, there was no impediment to him. Yet there he sat, across the fire from me, as far to the east as I had been, but it was only the gate doors, a nice broad pass between low mountains to north and south. It had taken him 12 years to walk back to where we were. This he told me. Finally, I had to ask him, why did you come back? Having gone so far, why turn around? Why not keep going for the rest of your life? He stared into the fire for a long, long time before he met my eye and answered me. When I was as far east as I got, he said, I came to a hill and went up it to look. I was feeling poorly and my feet hurt. And no person I had met for several years spoke any word I understood. All my demons were done by sign, and you can do that and still get by, but after a while, you want a word that people you see. I, Pippi, could only agree to that. And so, he said, he stood on that hill, and all to the east was just the same. There was no sign at all it would ever change. I realized, he said, that this world is just too big. You can't have it all, no matter how much you want it. It's bigger than any man can walk in one life. Possibly, it just keeps going on forever. Possibly, our Mother Earth is round, he said then, like a pregnant one, or the moon. And if you walked long enough, you would come around to where you started, assuming the Great Salt Sea did not stop you. But really, there is no way to know for sure. And so I turned back, he said, because the world is too big. And most of all, I wanted to talk to somebody again before I died. Having said that, having told his tale, we stood and hugged, and he cried so hard I thought he would choke. I had to hold him up. Whether he had succeeded or failed in his life walk, he did not know, and I didn't either. After that, he calmed down, and we looked at the fire until long the night, telling other stories we knew. Before bed, I asked him, so what's for you now? What will you do now that you're back? Well, he said, to tell the truth, I'm thinking I may take off these
tickets. Well, that's helpful because it directly relates to something I wanted to ask you about, which is that so many of your characters are curious, and curiosity seems to be one of the things that drives them, whether or not they're 23rd century scientists, or in this case, people from 30,000 years before. So I wonder if you could just expand a little bit on this question of the curiosity and characters that have that quality.
Well, it seems, I mean, it's fundamental to science and to us being alive on this planet. This book tries to make the case that we've been a technological species, or say a high-tech species forever, and really co-evolved as such. The tools that we made and the travels that we made over the planet and this diaspora out of Africa was an accomplishment that required us to be ingenious and clever and curious and solving things by way of tools and procedures and expertise. And I mean, I'm sure most of you must be aware that this story that I told you is making a case that isn't at all clear. How well did they know their world? The 30,000 years ago, they're living in a little valley, they're only on foot. We have some archaeological evidence. There will be shells from the Mediterranean that are 1,000 miles up in Bohemia. But the thing is, did they get traded 5 miles at a time, valley to valley, or were there travelers that were making nomadic trips across long distances? There's no way to be sure. So what I was trying to, one of the main points I was trying to make in this book, but in this particular story, was speculative, because the archaeologists can't do it. Out of the physical remnants, we can't be sure. But I have the feeling that because of curiosity, and because of storytelling, and because people can actually, in an ambulatory way, on foot, cover enormous distances, especially as strong as they were and as used to it as they were, as walking is their only mode of transport, that I had the feeling that they would have a sense of Europe, of where they were that could be shared by travelers telling the stories as a shared body of knowledge. 32,000 years ago, you've got a culture that is probably at that point 20,000 years old. So I thought it was possible that the news would have spread. And the Native Americans that were first encountered by Europeans, especially in the Bay Area around California, they would make sand maps. They would make maps in the sand that were just representations in 3D, like a topo map. Of the Bay Area to show the Europeans what the Bay Area looked like and where it worked. So by working by inference backwards, the way that anthropologists do, I had to do the kind of speculation that informs this point. So, and then that's just one example of the curiosity, but that's such a general trait of us all. I think you almost could say that of any science fiction writer.
And you get a little sense of it in that piece as well, that sometimes what the characters in this book are doing is something like improving a tool. At other times, it's sort of metaphorically trying to grasp the sort of universes. They're producing metaphysics that extend way beyond these particular practices. And it relates also to the titles. And I wonder if you could say a little bit about the figure of the shaman, who also reappears in your novels about the future as well. It seems to be another side in your thinking to curiosity that's about that role.
Well, I thought if you were going to do a novel about the Ice Age, and their culture, that it's again speculative to say that it was a shaman culture. Or even if you run it like DNA studies, where we follow mitochondrial DNA or Y chromosome back to, you can begin to follow the human diaspora backwards in time. And in terms of people's belief systems and religions, for shamanism to be that widespread, it suggests that it was with us when we left Africa in the first place, 100,000 years ago. It's by far the oldest religion, the first religion, so to speak. And for my purposes, it was perfect because the current strongest theory for who painted those Chauvet caves is the shaman cult. And this is Jean-Claude, the dean of French archaeologists, and a colleague of his from South Africa named Davis Lewis Williams. And their theory is controversial because what many archaeologists would say, being conservative and being scientists, saying, we don't know enough to make this kind of speculation. You can't prove it. Therefore, when you say it, you're doing, in effect, an act of science fiction, but we're trying to keep this science, not science fiction. But what they're saying is, it had to have been done for a reason. It wasn't hunting magic, probably, because you don't see any scenes of hunting to speak of. It wasn't teenage boys going into caves and doing graffiti and pornography on a dare, which is the other competing theory these days by Bill Guthrie from University of Alaska. And none of those theories are as good as the shaman theory, and what they use as their evidence is the abstract paintings. Grid works, wavy lines, dots. These are all the first somatic visual hallucinations of people coming on psychedelics. So, especially in South America, the taking and ingesting of psychoactive drugs is part of the shaman cult. You go to other worlds, right? You become your spirit, and you take off and you encounter spirit beings, animal beings, and so but the first sign that strange things are happening are exactly what are painted on the cave in these abstract forms. And there's very few abstract paintings in the case, but they always conform to these models. So they're saying that's as good evidence as anything else we're going to find about why people did things 30,000 years ago, given that the paintings themselves are relatively mute on the issue. They're beautiful animals. It's clear humans really, really paying attention to animals. They're really good zoologists, and they tell us things about those animals that we didn't know before, especially the ones that are extinct. And they're really good on whether they're pregnant or not, whether it's spring or fall. You can tell an awful lot about the animals. They are not just kids fooling around or abstract representations. They're very specific animals. So for all these reasons, I thought, well, this is really good. You've got essentially the first religion, but also the first artists, the first scientists. And first is never the right word when you're talking about a culture that at that point is tens of thousands of years old. So my first idea for like the way that I tried to describe this book to people before it was a book, was that it's going to be the first artist, or maybe it's going to be the first scientist. I'm not sure which. I'm interested in both. And my agent at that time said, well, maybe you should just call it first. And it was only when I began to process it that I began to realize that first is absolutely not what they were. They were deep into a long tradition at that point, which is a point that I had to make.
Mm-hmm. Would it be fair to describe what they're doing as a kind of speculative realism, that science can tell us certain things, but we're constrained in how we can generalize that, but is to kind of create a possible world around what's known, so that we can think about it as a whole?
Oh, sure. That would be a good description. A kind of a thick texture, as they say in historiography, a thick texture or simply fiction, making it into a novel. A novel is a mode of being, a mode of thinking. So that when you've got something in a novel, you've got it in a way that you don't have in other descriptions. And so the archaeologists that are serious are going to say, look, let's just not make inferences that we don't have any evidence for, or else what are we doing? It's similar to these arguments in theoretical physics, that once you get to string theory, you can't do any experiments, so at that point it's some kind of aesthetics. It's like the aesthetics of mathematics. Maybe the world is made out of strings that are 10 to the 0.34th meter across, but since we can never tell, we can't run any experiments, is that really physics anymore? So our archaeologists make the same argument. They say, look, if there's no evidence for it, you don't get to say it. But I'm a novelist, so I get to say it. So we have no evidence that they had snowshoes 32,000 years ago, because everything made of wood, cloth, straw, is gone. I'm sure they had snowshoes. I'm just as sure as I would be that a culture that lived in snow for 10,000 years is going to look at the snow leopards and hogs. They're going to look at the way wolverines land on that floor, they deposit once when they're on snow to give themselves a bigger platform for their weight. And they're going to say, hey, good idea, and since I finished this book, I find in one of the archaeological articles in Europe that the ice man found between Italy and Austria in 1991, well, he was frozen with all his gear, and there were some broken wood pieces that were down ice from him that they said at first were part of a frame for a backpack. Well, now they're saying that probably was a snowshoe. So now we have 5,000 years old snowshoe, but I'm positive they're 50,000 years old. So I put them in the book. Same with things like fireworks. And I don't mean full-on fireworks, but I'm thinking that if you're by the campfire every night for 10,000 years, and sometimes they flare up green or orange or purple or blue, but this is unusual enough you'd say, why did that happen? And if it turned out to be certain mineral compounds, ochre or whatever burns these colors in the dust around, that you begin to make those statues of them, and during the festival, then you stick that statue out into the fire in the middle and make it suddenly, boom, a little tiny burst of green. And it would be a kind of a party thing for fun.
Well,
it's exactly early entertainment while I'm watching the fire. I mean, there's many a social biologist who said that we all go to the movies and we sit in the dark, and it doesn't matter whether the movie is crap or not. It's really just flickering things in the dark while you're sitting there. It's a campfire. Mm-hmm. The movies are basically campfires. Mm-hmm. And so, an archaeologist didn't say that, but it makes a nice touch to try to imagine the thick texture of life.
In this book, and you've done elsewhere as well, imagining humans in a very different climate to the one that most of us are used to. I wonder if there's some particular intention in writing that story now.
Well, we are in climate change, and there is a political statement being made by a certain class of, you might call them op-ed commentators or popular sociobiologists slash political commentators. They're saying that we're really bad at planning, that we were made for fight and flight as a species, and therefore we can't plan to fight climate change because we're bad at planning and we're going to be bad. And usually the people who say that actually have very bad plans of their own for the future. we can't plan, but by the way, we have a master plan. And what I'd like to say in this book and in all of my statements is that actually we are very good at planning, that that we evolved as creatures by planning food through dangers. Mm-hmm. It's very interesting long-term planning that we did, that we're aware of our own deaths, and that we actually are good at long-term planning, and now we have to again. So this polemical line is basically anti-government. It's a sort of right-wing point when people say, oh, humans aren't good at planning. This is because they like the plan they've got. So this is part of our political battle of our time, and we are in climate change. We're going to have to deal. And since people did such a good job of dealing with it, with much fewer resources, much less power per person, so that people didn't even have one horsepower per person, they had one people power per person, and yet they were still getting by and surviving, gathering enough food, protecting themselves from predators, all the things that they did. And there were some spectacular emergencies that are emerging in our DNA record. About 70,000 years ago, there was a disaster. And probably this lake Tambu or Tabu in Indonesia is a volcanic remnant. 70,000 years ago, it put out like a 10 to 100 times as much volcanic dust as the biggest explosion we've ever seen. It created the year without summer in 1816. And so right around that same time, 70,000 years ago, our DNA record shrinks to about 2,000 individuals on the whole planet, which is really, when you think about it, that's a near extinction event. And probably it was a nuclear winter, a volcanic winter, that lasted 10 to 20 years. Mm-hmm. And what do you eat when suddenly someone goes away for 10 years? Well, I have a poem devoted to that as well, earlier in the book, where they remember the time when summer didn't come for 10 long years, and they ended up basically living by the seashores and eating clams and mussels, and that's the only thing that was still available to eat for about 10 years. And the thing is, that was 70,000 years ago. This book is 30,000 years ago. Again, I'm making that point. Could people remember something for 40,000 years by oral memory alone? Well, maybe not, but Plato wrote down the explosion of Santorini, because that's the destruction of Atlantis, right? And we know that Santorini blew up in like 1643 BC, and we know that Plato wrote down the story of Atlantis around 600 or 500 BC, so for 1,000 years, people told this story, pretty much like the Trojan War. And basically all the details are right, except for it's the scale is expanded by a factor of 10. So Atlantis is like 10 times bigger than Santorini. But other than that, everything else matches. So I was going to make the point that when you've got a story that big, you never get rid of the story of the 10 years without summer. Mm-hmm. And that will just keep getting told over and over and over and over and over and get honed down and forget details and make up other details, but the story will still be there. So in other words, the book was an opportunity to make various statements about how we lived, our revolutionary past, what we are as human beings. So it's a kind of a science fictional point there also. When you think about science fiction, you think, well, science fiction is always about what could we become in the future. And you can't really talk about that very much until you come to some basic understanding of what we are, and also how we became what we are. So to answer the first question, you have to ask the second question. It's a looking forward question to answer it by looking back. And you get this, this was the thinking that went into the process of me writing these books in this order. 20 through 12 looking forward, this one looking back.
It seems, there's a little handful of writers who have tackled this particular terrain. You seem to have done something a little different to many of them, in that it's not a sort of Malthusian red and tooth and claw thing, nor is it a sort of utopia and pastoral landscape that your characters cooperate, but there is, I don't want to give away that story, but there's an ambiguity about their cooperation and some complexity to how they pull this off. There's a big rescue and so on.
Different ecologies, so they have a kind of Arctic culture being different than a Provençal culture and a Mediterranean culture just by way of the landscapes, enforcing different kinds of culture, like we saw on the Earth anyway. Mm. And I don't think that it was either utopian or red in the tooth and claw. There are some great prehistoric novels out there, and there are some dreadful ones, like any other genre. Amongst the great ones is one very famous, which is Golding's The Inheritors. But because that book was about the Neanderthal, I felt free to do something different. It would have been scary to have a Golding novel that was about the Cro-Magnon, because he really was an absolutely brilliant writer and novelist. And The Inheritors is a permanently great novel. Mm. But it was about the Neanderthal getting killed off by the Cro-Magnon, which may or may not have happened, but it remains a great novel. Mm. And there are some other big ones, some of them rather obscure, others fairly well known. I would say Elizabeth Marshall Thomas's books, Reindeer Moon, exceptionally good. She was brought up by her father in Kalahari as a child and lived with what we call the bush people, the Kung. And so her feel for the priesthood culture is better than most people's feel, I think. And there are some other good ones, and there are some things bad ones.
Although it's something like the Neanderthal make an appearance in
Peru. Oh, yes, I have too. Yeah. One of the good things about Chauvet cave being choosing this cave as opposed to, say, Lascaux or Altamira, is that the Chauvet cave is about twice as old. It's 32,000 years old, and Lascaux is 17, and Altamira is 16, in terms of when they were painted. Well, by 17 and 16,000 years ago, the Neanderthal effectively were gone. But at 32,000, they were still probably around, because we find, this is all a little contested, but they think they found Neanderthal in southern Spain that are 24,000 years old. And I decided that was good enough. We had to tell their story about it. Because it is a great story.
Yeah.
For sure, they coexisted in Europe. And we have, what is it, something like 4 or 5% of Neanderthal DNA in our bodies right now. Mm-hmm. So things were going on between the two species, but this concept of the uncanny valley, somebody that is like you but not like you in a truly profound way, that's a creepy, the uncanny valley is very uncanny. So I thought that was a great opportunity, and I have one Neanderthal character, and if we get to know fairly well. A little too well.
But in a good way. It's curious to me because in, blank on the title, 2312, the novel meaning.
I mean, before this, we re-speciated humans.
Yeah, that's
right.
Off again.
That's true. Yep.
And so it's maybe the one species humanoid is a sort of a blueprint in evolutionary history.
It could be. I thought with our biotechnologies that we might become not just speciate, but maybe become like dogs. So if you think that dogs are one species, and you walk around New York and you see a Great Dane and then you see a little schnauzer, you think, well, that's one species. Humans could do that over a forcing action over time, relatively quickly. So in 2312, I have people who are 10 feet tall and people who are 2.5 feet tall, and a lot of people who are gender indeterminate, let's say. And that was my way of saying that we may play out like that. I don't know. I mean, that was one of the ways I was just trying to boggle people's minds. Given an assignment by my editor, write our story 300 years in the future, I mean, that's way too far. How could I do it? But the obvious one thing you had to do is really try to surprise people or shock people. Mm. So in a way, it's a little mechanical. Okay, if I blow my own mind, then maybe the reader will feel the same. So I began to think, well, what would freak me out?
What treatments?
Yeah, good. I mean, one of the classic sort of critical formulas for science fiction is, of course, estrangement and cognition. So you have distance, but there has to be some logical cognitive plausibility of the scenario. Do you think that's a reasonable description?
I do, yes.
And as you consider yourself a science fiction writer, I shouldn't really just ask that.
I
can get out of it if you want.
No, I am a science fiction writer and a patriot of the genre, I would say.
That's a wonderful phrase.
Yeah, it's been my mode of being and also my intellectual community. And a lot of what's good in my work is actually comes out of the genre itself and me tweaking it. And the way that the interaction between artist and genre is really crucial. And I very much dislike those artists that will write science fiction and claim that they did it because I think it's chicken shit on yeah, and also give some credit where credit is due. They're not geniuses that have thought up all this stuff out of their own heads, and that would be a ridiculous claim for any novelist to make. And yet you see people trying to squirm away, probably for commercial reasons as to how many books can you sell, how many readers. On a generous level, you could say they want to reach as many readers as possible, so they don't want definition. Mm-hmm. But at a certain point, it gets very bad faith. And ungenerous on that part. So yes, I'm a science fiction writer, and it's Darko Suvin who talks about cognitive estrangement, and I think that's one good way to put it. He's really working off a prep, and the V effect, the Fremden effect, the stranger effect, estrangement, that Brecht wanted to do in theater, and Suvin was saying that science fiction does that all the time, that it presents you with stuff that you think at first that's very estranging and weird,
But when you see the logic of why it is the way it is, then you look at your own time with new eyes. And that's the science fiction trick, that the method, the thing that it wants to do, principally. And it can be very good at that. I mean, I think that regular science fiction readers, people who have read it and enjoyed it on a regular basis, they walk around a city like this or anywhere on Earth with a better sense of cognitive mapping. Like Jameson talked about in his postmodernism, that you orient yourself in your culture and in your space and time by way of cognitive maps, and that you're better at it if you have the forward-lookingness of science fiction. Mm. And I recently was at an all-day set of panels at the Library of Congress, and people were doing science fiction all day. It was the long-term possibilities for human civilization. Will we survive? And what I realized was that the more people had spent time in science fiction, the less they were making the first approximations to a thought. Mm. And the people who hadn't spent any time in there were essentially espousing ideas new to them and rather glorious that in science fiction had been discussed in the 1940s. And so people are reinventing the wheel in that sense by not being science fiction readers.
There's a lovely passage in 2313 where you flooded the whole of New York City, including this neighborhood. But it's unlike most versions of it, particularly by Californians. People are just dealing.
Yeah.
Right? It's you make it work, and it's you describe quite beautifully the street life where all this is already on the water. So thank you for that.
That was a lot of fun. I postulated an 11-meter sea level rise, so that's about 35 feet. And in 300 years, that would probably require the West Antarctica sheet to have come off. And really climate change unconstrained, which not at all impossible, although it's really rapid compared to what IPCC will now admit to being impossible. But see, they usually only go out about 100 years and then say, we just don't know. And if you have a 3-foot rise in 100 years, then 35-foot rise in 300 years, it's not completely impossible, because the ice is going to break off. It isn't going to just melt. Mm-hmm. It's going to fall into the sea and then much more quickly than it would in the air. So, but once you get to 35 feet higher sea level, then New York becomes super interesting. Because it's not all underwater, but a lot of it is. But with the skyscrapers, with the built infrastructure, you could just have Venice. That's really what it comes down to. Mm-hmm. The skyscrapers are very well connected to the Earth. You could flood to the third floor of this city, and then everybody just adjusts. And over 300 years, are they really going to abandon this place? No. It'll become Venice, and Venice, of course, is a very beautiful city. So.
What I find interesting about that aspect of your writing is that you're taking things like climate change very seriously, but in a way that you can feel your way through it. But in ways, is this not harder to think and work with than some sort of apocalyptic scenario? I mean, thinking how you actually do it seems to me to be the thing that we avoid, because it's easier to just imagine.
But I'm thinking that there's this unfortunate strain of apocalyptic thinking in American culture in general, and in the environmental movement, and in the talk about climate change. And what I would like to say is that although climate change might lead to a mass extinction event, and it might even threaten the human species and horribly damage civilization, it still is probably going to be historical rather than apocalyptic. And there are going to be people coping with it, and it's kind of a slow motion disaster. And at a certain point, people may get into geoengineering. People may begin to say, this is so bad, then let's try to deflect 20% of the sunlight from hitting the Earth, and let's create some artificial volcanic sulfur dioxide, or the various methods that people talk about might be better than the alternative of a mass extinction event that kills off all life in the ocean, at which point we've lost 1/3 of our food. So it's going to get real strange, I think, no matter what. Given where we are right now, the next 200-300 years are going to be strange and traumatic, but not the end of life as we a life on Earth. Even a mass extinction event will probably be survived by human beings, and it will be like some horrible tragedy, because it will be devastating to all the other big mammals, and extinction we can't work back from. So I think it's worth waving a flag and saying, this is terrible, we've got to do something. But also when you portray it, to not have the Mad Max or the Road or one of these everything ends novels, because those aren't quite what will happen. It's better to do a realism. Mm. At least that's my that's my almost my only working method, is once you postulate something, what would it work like as a realism, and see what you get. And then you've got historical information of what kind of method.
Yeah, that word historical is a very helpful way to try to rub it back into the genres that deal with history, rather than some almost metaphysical break.
Yes, and then you also kind of change one's definitions of things about utopia also. Because if mostly I do utopian fiction, but if you think of utopia as a name for one kind of history, rather than a current end state, then you get something more interesting, and something more likely to happen. Because one of the famous criticisms of utopian thinking and utopian literature is that they always seem to be a fresh start somehow. Starting with Thomas More's Utopia and maybe The Winds of Dispossessed. And most utopian novels will create what they call the Great Trench in Utopia, a break, a fundamental break between the society as it exists now and the utopian society. Well, utopian thinking, well, you have to graft it onto art history. And at that point, it no longer is a perfect society, but it's just a better one in incremental ways. Mm-hmm. And then it has to be defended, and then you get plots, you get stories that are more historical.
The thing I particularly admired about Blue Mars, which concludes your Mars books, is that you then actually run Utopia for some quite long period of time to show how difficult it actually is. And here is a very, very fine society, but it still has conflict and struggle.
Yeah, and it still has death, and it still has lost love. So something I've been saying for an awful long time now, just because you're a utopia doesn't mean you're going to be happy. That's how utopia is.
Just not tortured.
Just not tortured. Only the necessary tragedies, yeah. Not the unnecessary tragedies. So that would be a huge accomplishment.
Well, the incremental overcoming of unnecessary suffering is the old formula of Fagin socialism. Mm-hmm. It seems to me that your books conform to some degree to something like that.
Well, but you can only get a certain point in that way, because we are going to remain mortal, and our emotional lives are going to remain, you know, traumatized.
That one where nothing necessary suffering.
Yes, it's the unavoidable suffering.
And I want to ask you just to backtrack a little bit, what kind of readerships do you find science fiction connects? Is there a sort of particular morphology of who finds this a genre that speaks to them?
Well, this is guesswork on my part. I don't think anyone really knows. The data aren't there. Mm-hmm. So people say things. They say, well, you hear things that are just quite amazing. You say, well, nobody really reads fiction in this culture but women. And then you'll hear, well, nobody reads science fiction but men. And I'm thinking, does that leave anybody left to read it? And so, what we get in science fiction, I think, is traditional. Mm-hmm. And I think there's enough evidence that we can talk about this historically. You get young people, because they're interested in the future. Mm-hmm. What will life be like for me when things go further on? You get the engineering classes, and particularly in the 1930s, 1940s, you got first lots of men, and these men were often wanted to be engineers, even though they lived on farms and on ranches. So someone in New York literature, and the early American science fiction writers, but they were their books were and their magazines were going out to mailboxes in the rural West. People were picking this stuff and thinking, okay, right now I'm behind a plow with a couple of oxen, but I'm going to be on Mars by the time I'm an adult. And that's why they ran into mailboxes to give them these books for the kids. So the engineering class, the sense that the future was going to be usually more interesting than they were. Well, and then also, quickly, especially post-war, you get a lot of women thinking, well, if the future is going to be different, that would be good. So then you get the feminist science fiction. In the post-war period, that became people like Seal Moore and Judith Merrow, really great early American women science fiction writers, turning into, okay, we're not going to have galactic suburbia, we're going to have a feminist utopian future of various kinds, and began to play with it. Because that was one thing the future allowed, was difference. Mm-hmm. So that was a main point. So now, who knows, I do think that now, because science fiction is theoretically complicated because it's not a realism, it's not straightforward domestic realism, then you get a lot of theoretical interest in the postmodern period. It's some kind of postmodernism. What that means is open to discussion, but it means that there's a lot more academic interest in science fiction than there was back when academia was locked into hegemonism as the only mode of goodness. And now, you know, high modernism is kind of a residual. And in the postmodern culture, everything is equally full of possibility artistically. So science fiction gets a lot of interest at the academy. And so once again, it comes back to college students, but now also college professors. And that's a good interaction because then they've read the same thing because they want to, and not because it's being imposed on them from the inside. So I see a lot of good, but just to finish that, I would say also in the last, 10 years or so, what I've seen is the rise of fantasy as opposed to science fiction. And what I think that is a young people who no longer feel like the future is going to be a good place, and are now, the future is looking ominous. So those future fictions you do see are dystopian, like the Hunger Games. And what you also get is Harry Potter and Lord of the Rings. And the attractiveness of that, I think, is at least twofold. One, I mean, magic works, so that's cool, magic thinking. But the thing is, you can distinguish good from bad easily in fantasy, and you get to chop bad's head off with an axe. And that's not something that in our contemporary world you get, because here it's really ambiguous, and we're often being told that actually our habits are the bad guys. So it's not so easy to chop that from the axe. Mm-hmm. And the young people are thinking, I'd rather have it simple. And then also, they get to spend a lot of their imaginative life out in the forest, riding a horse. And so they're finally away from their goddamn screens. So it's compensatory. They read fantasy in order to get exactly away from the life that they've been living in the USA suburban internet and screens.
Just explain my 10-year-old sons.
My 20-year-old and my 18-year-old are very much into that world. But I think it makes sense that they read light fantasy and they read high fantasy in order to get back to a mental life that they aren't living themselves. Because we do read to compensate. We read to escape. We read fiction to get into worlds that we aren't quite getting in our normal lives.
But the sort of dark version, it's more like China Yang, where we have this other reality that has a magic, but there ain't no forest.
That's right.
Bleak industrial landscapes.
Mayville's doing a very different thing than Harry Potter.
Of course. But fantasy is a weird genre to contain those things.
Yeah, but it's a distinguished... it used to be that fantasy was a tiny little subgenre of science fiction. And you talked about the bookstore, the culture, the writers, and the whole intellectual milieu. But now the valences are almost reversed. Mm-hmm. And I think it's attitudes towards the future.
Mm-hmm. At least changed. Yeah. There's a sense in which you could also describe really all your work as historical novel, but of histories about which we actually don't have historical evidence, we have other evidence, or ones that haven't happened. Or do you say a little bit of that historical thought?
Yes. I mean, this is something that I've been saying for a long time. I think that science fiction is the fiction that is about the histories that we can never know. And so I say histories on purpose because you, first of all, the future, that's the obvious one. But the future could be anything from utopia to dystopia, so you've got futures already, but you can never know them because we're never going to be in the future. So science fiction is that. But also science fiction is alternative history. And that doesn't immediately make sense, and yet it's absolutely true in terms of the bookstores and the culture. Alternative history is at some moment in the past something different happened. The Axis went to World War II, or the one that I put my effort into, all the Europeans died in the Black Death. At that point, you follow the history from that point to some alternative space. That can never be known either, right? We'll never get to those. And then lastly, I think that the reason that prehistorical novels are very often in the science fiction section is that prehistory, too, is history that we can never know because we don't have the data. And we actually are getting better at excavating things that we can infer from, but the history itself is not known for sure. Oh, man, blah, blah, blah. You look at those paintings in the Shogun cave, you're thinking, okay, something happened. What was it? You'll never know it, but then science fiction allows you at least to speculate about it. So this is why science fiction has these somewhat disparate subgenres. Mm-hmm. They're always historical. And it also is a neat distinction between science fiction and fantasy, because science fiction, especially the future ones, there's a historical connection from that future world back to the present. And it's either explicit in the text, it's described as a history, or else it's implicit, you have to guess it by guessing it, which is one of the games of reading science fiction, well, how to get there. And the clues are there if you need to figure it out. Well, think of Lord of the Rings. Middle Earth, it has an internal history. It never connects to our history. Mm-hmm. And so fantasy used to be bubble worlds. And so one of the ways you could say it wasn't a science fiction novel was that it didn't have a historical connection to our mind. Mm-hmm. And now, the moment that I say that, the moment that people begin to intuit that, a game arises. Let's put a fantasy situation in where Coleridge is dealing with magical demons. So when he's in his opium fantasies, he's seeing what's really there rather than what he's dreaming of. You know, so you get...
I mean that.
You get historical fantasy. Well, that's Tim Powers. You do this.
It exists.
Yeah.
Okay.
And then you get urban... Well, what if there's magical creatures running around the sewers in New York? Well, then you've got urban fantasy, and supposedly it's in our timeline. But really, I still think the distinction is useful as a first
cut. It's famously fraught territory in the critical literature, because fantasy was a bad object for Dr. Susan and lots of people.
Well, that's right. He thought that it wasn't being political enough.
It was basically fascist.
Yes, and that there was some kind of fascist retro look to high fantasy, that it was basically Wagner. I mean, The Lord of the Rings is the ring cycle put into narrative form without the music.
Mm-hmm. Where the white guy's the heroes.
Exactly. But there's much more fantasy than that.
Yeah, that's true.
It's gotten very much more political. Mm-hmm. I mean, Daniel's not the only one, but he certainly is a great explainer mm-hmm. of what's going on with fantasy right now.
Another thing I wanted to pick up again a little bit is that theme of utopia, and whether it's even still possible to write in that utopia vein in the 21st century, and what spaces might still exist to do so.
Well, I certainly think so, but I know that I'm unusual in this regard, and maybe the only serial offender in modern times in terms of writing a utopian novel after a utopian novel. The only other person I can think of who has ever done this is H.G. Wells. And, I like his stubbornness in the going through the first half of the 20th century and writing utopian novel after utopian novel, obviously against the grain of history at that time. Right. And I think he probably had a worse dynamic to face than we do now. And yet he wrote utopias, and I think that they're permanently useful, because from this point on, were we to do everything right, 7 billion people, the planet we're on, the climate situation, the technology. We could work into a stable civilization, stable in terms of population, sustainability, resource use, getting rid of wastes, everybody adequate or better, all the other mammals doing well. That's not at all a physically impossible. It is actually quite physically possible. It's tricky, and it would be a technological accomplishment, and it requires the technologies that we call justice, that we call law, and those are technologies too. But since it's doable, since we can do it, we should. This has been my working fun. Mm-hmm. And then it needs to be described in advance as some visions. Well, what would it be like? You know, or, oh, that's impossible. I mean, it couldn't happen. Well, if you write it down that it could happen, people at least have to say, oh, he's so unrealistic. Oh, he's so optimistic. Oh, he's so possible angle because of this utilitarianism. Mm-hmm. And I understand where they're coming from, because really novels have a default setting of being realism. And it's a kind of an art that's saying this is the way life is, and when you read a good novel, you go, yeah, that's the way life is. And that's a good response. I love that response when I read a novel, and I realize that what I'm reading is a description of reality that strikes me as utterly right. And I didn't know it before in that way, but by reading the novel, I know that that's true. Well, you read a utopian novel, and that doesn't work at all. You have to be caught in the mystery. You're going, oh, wait, would it really work? People are just so screwed up that they never read this. And so you read in a kind of contradiction between what is and what ought to be, which is a famous philosophical contradiction.
But there seem to be two sort of ethical principles there that are kind of important. The first is doable, and the second is, well, why not? And at least as I read it, you're creating this set of fictional practices where one can at least entertain those two propositions.
They're highly political, and of course novels are not supposed to be political. But of course they are. Mm. So what you do is admit that all novels are political, and then you see whether you can control it. And that, I think, is one of the things that is going on in science fiction and in utopian fiction. Is you admit that they're political, and then you try to make them still aesthetically pleasing. And I would say that the greatest novel ever written is Marcel Proust's In Search of Lost Time, and that's an intensely political novel about the Dreyfus case and about the snobism of the aristocracy of the late bourgeois moment. And so it's a satire, it's highly political, but it's also the most beautiful object that we call a novel amongst all the objects that we call novels. So I take huge encouragement from Marcel and his Corpine Room in Paris. One of the weirdest guys ever to write novels. And that's also very comforting. You know, it's the correlation between weirdness and greatness is not a lot. It can be a